Time and time again, our nation has witnessed the tragic consequences of this administration's failure to enforce immigration law. Witnessing these tragedies is unsettling enough, but it pales in comparison to the grief and the anguish and the separation experienced by the families of those victimized. But today, we're not here merely to discuss the failure to enforce the law. It's even more disconcerting than that. We're here today because the Department of Justice, the entity that is supposed to be the chief enforcer of the law, is aiding and abetting local governments in the failure to enforce the law. Once again, the temptation to make a political point has transcended the obligation to take care that the law be faithfully executed. Under current policy, the New Orleans Police Department prevents its officers and employees from communicating with U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement regarding the immigration status of an arrestee. In May of 2010, New Orleans Mayor Mitchell Andrews sent a letter to then Attorney General Holder, requesting DOJ, quote, transform the New Orleans Police Department, close quote. Based on the Department of Justice report, current Labor Secretary, then Civil Rights Division head, Thomas Perez, filed a lawsuit against the City of New Orleans and the Police Department, alleging various civil rights violations. On the basis of that lawsuit, the parties entered into a consent decree in 2012, which was approved by a federal court in 2013. This consent decree stated the New Orleans Police Department officers, quote, shall not take law enforcement action on the basis of actual or perceived immigration status, including the initiation of stops or other field contacts. And let me read the salient part of that again. Police officers shall not take law enforcement action on the basis of actual immigration status. And on February 28, 2016, New Orleans Police Department issued a written policy entitled Immigration Status, which, number one, prohibits officers from inquiring about an individual's immigration status. Number two, prohibits officers from assisting or supporting ICE's immigration enforcement, and number three, mandates any ICE request for support or assistance be declined. The New Orleans Police Department policy was not only vetted, but, quote, enthusiastically approved and supported by DOJ's Civil Rights Division. It was also reviewed and approved by DHS. The Department of Justice and Department of Homeland Security enthusiastically approve and support the failure of law enforcement to take note of federal immigration laws. In addition to being mind-numbingly antithetical to the faithful execution of the law, which is among the primary responsibilities of the executive branch, this New Orleans policy statement appears to violate Section 8 U.S.C. Code 1373, which provides no person or agency may prohibit or restrict federal, state, or local agency from sending, requesting, receiving, or exchanging information with ICE regarding unlawfully present aliens. On May 28th of this year, Chairman Goodlatte sent a letter to now Attorney General Lynch demanding that she explain DOJ's role in initiating litigation against the City of New Orleans and the resulting consent decree, and provide the legal justification for approving the sanctuary policies enacted by the police department. On May 31st of this year, DOJ Inspector General Michael Horowitz issued a memo to the Assistant Attorney General for Justice Programs in response to a request to investigate allegations that over 140 state and local jurisdictions received DOJ grant funds and they may be in violation of federal law. Specifically, the Inspector General was requested to investigate allegations the 140 jurisdictions who are recipients of funding from the Department of Justice are in violation of Title 8 U.S.C. Section 1373. For those of you who may be struck by the duplicity of the chief federal law enforcement entity providing grant money to state and municipalities who specifically fail to assist in the enforcement of federal law, you are not alone. The Inspector General found the laws and policies in several jurisdictions go beyond regulating responses to ICE detainers and also address in some way the sharing of information with federal immigration authorities. After specifically reviewing the language of the New Orleans Police Department policy, and the Inspector General found, and I quote, In our view, subsection A of the policy would not serve as a, quote, savings clause in addressing section 1373. Thus, unless the understanding of the police department's employees is they are not prohibited or restricted from sharing information, sharing immigration status information with ICE, the policy would be inconsistent with section 1373. On July 7th, DOJ's Office of Justice Programs determined section 1373 is, quote, an applicable federal law for purposes of determining statutory eligibility for relevant DOJ grant funding. Yet despite the requirement of section 1373, DOJ awarded the Police Department New Orleans approximately $2 million in grants for fiscal year 2015. That very same day, July 7th, DOJ responded to Chairman Goodlatte's letter. And they outlined the policy, but they failed to explain how the New Orleans policies are lawful, which was a pretty important part of the letter in the first place. Then last Friday, September 23rd, just a few days after our hearing was announced, we received a letter from the Department of Justice claiming the revised policy the New Orleans Police Department at issue did comply with 1373. However, this revised policy makes no mention of Part B of Section 1373. And in addition, DOJ has not provided this committee with any indication of how officers will be trained to implement this revised policy or how seemingly minor changes to the text will ensure New Orleans will not be operating as a sanctuary city, which leads us to why we are here today. Not only does this place ICE agents and officers at greater risk when they're forced to arrest criminal aliens who are no longer in a secure jail facility, but instead in public places where they can more readily escape or assess a weapon, but it also prevents officers from accomplishing their ultimate goal, which is public safety. We already know there are cities more interested in providing sanctuary for criminals than a safe haven for our very own citizens. We know there are cities who clamor for the federal government to assert itself into matters that are not inherently federal in nature, but refuse to assist federal law enforcement in matters that actually are inherently federal. And to put this in terms that almost anyone can understand, state and local law enforcement can be trusted to provide security for members of Congress, both here and in our home districts. They can be entrusted to enforce murder laws, child sex laws, kidnapping laws. They can participate in federal task forces on terrorism and narcotics trafficking. But God forbid they lift a finger to assist in the enforcement of federal immigration laws. But for the Department of Justice to go as far as seek a consent decree to actually inhibit the ability of the federal government to enforce federal law is stunning. Even for a Department of Justice that has unfortunately become increasingly politicized. The consent decree can be interpreted to require New Orleans adopt policies that require its officers to actually violate federal law. Let me repeat that one more time. This administration's Department of Justice is actually requiring New Orleans police officers to break the law in an effort to further their political agenda. We have had multiple hearings on those that have been victimized by sanctuary cities. We've heard from their families. We're well aware of the tragic consequences. This is not a theoretical conversation in some law school conference room. This is real life with real victims and real grieving family members. Illegal immigration is not a victimless crime. Once you weaken the law, you weaken it forever. And once you put politics above the blind application of the law, it is done forever. And once you decide state and local law enforcement are good enough to protect us when we're back home in our districts, but not good enough to be trusted to assist in the execution of the law, good luck reversing that.